Romila Thapa's latest book is about what she calls the Indian cultures. It is an excellent book in the sense it offers a very clear insight into the way the academic sleights of hands are used to negatively stereotype Hinduism. I will take one particular article and analyze it. The article is titled Culture of Discrimination. In fact, she means by the culture of discrimination, the Indian culture or the Hindu culture. And she wants to stereotype the Hindu culture as the reason for all the social discrimination and social exclusion phenomena like untouchability that exist in India. So towards this end, when she develops a narrative, she has to leave out a lot of different aspects of Indian culture so that it will suit her narrative. I will start with one specific solid example. She starts explaining this social stratification starting with the Vedic culture. Now, if you want to actually study social exclusion or social discrimination, you should study social stratification. All Indologists know that the Harappan culture had a system of social stratification. For example, Airavata Mahadevan, studying the terminal signs in the Indus tablets, points out that they tend to show a kind of social classes like the priestly class, the warriors, the traders, the common men, etc. And if you really want to study this phenomenon of social exclusion, if you want to study then the history of social stratification, you should start with the Harappan culture. Romila Thapa never discusses Harappan culture. Why? There may be two reasons. One is that she does not subscribe to the idea that Harappan culture and the Vedic culture are organically related. She sees them as distinct. And then she wants to put all the blames for any negative social phenomenon on the Vedic culture. So if she starts with the Harappan culture, then she cannot put the entire blame on the Vedic culture. So she starts with the Vedic culture. This kind of nuanced distortions exist throughout the book. According to her, after the decline of Buddhism and Jainism, the Vedic religion started reviving itself with state power. In doing so, it created social exclusion based on its own scriptural basis of ritual pollution. So, she puts the entire blame of untouchability proliferating, particularly during the 4th century and 5th century, during the Gupta era, on Hinduism. Now, what is the problem with this thesis is that we have very clear evidence that Buddhism and Jainism also played an important role in making social groups untouchables. So, the strong moralist tendencies as well as the extreme emphasis on non-violence made the dancers, the bard, the hunters, the fishermen defiled professions. And once these people became defiled, and remember during the pre-modern times the occupations were based on hereditary everywhere in the world, not only in India. Once these traits were identified as defiled, then these groups became untouchables. However, Romila Thapa never touches this particular phenomenon. Though there is a lot of evidence in Buddha Jataka tales, in the Buddhist scriptures, in the sutras for social exclusion of occupational groups and also based on birth, there is a defilement of trades and guilds. So, actually, untouchability in a way proliferated with Buddhism and Jainism, and we have more importantly literary evidence that when there was a revival of Vedic religion along with the Bhakti movement, there was a conscious movement to remove groups from untouchability and bring them back into empowered mainstream. So, in the book, Romila Thapa gives an example of Vishwamitra's encounters with the Chandala. This is very interesting because in the conversation, the Chandala and Vishwamitra argue about Vishwamitra eating the flesh of a dead animal, a dog, so that he could survive the famine. But the Chandala says, you are a high born person, a noble person, so you should not eat the meat of that particular dog. So she uses this to show that it was the food based pollution concept that created the Chandalas. However, if you go through the entire literature, there are more than one encounter with Chandala. In the Mahabharata itself, there is an encounter with the Chandala, that is the encounter between Vishwamitra and Chandala, but it is well described in the proper historical context in both Harivamsa and Vishnu Purana. The Chandala who speaks to Vishwamitra is none other than Trishangu, who was actually the ancestor of Sri Rama. Trishangu becomes a Chandala because Vasishta curses him, and he comes and approaches Vishwamitra, and then Vishwamitra does a yajna in which the Chandala is the yajamana of the yajna, and after that the son of the Chandala becomes the king, the Harichandra, and Harichandra also later becomes the manager of a crematorium, a defiled profession. And then again the lineage of Harichandra, they don't have any problem in becoming the kings of Ayodhya. So the point is the Chandala concept was not birth based, but again Romila Thapar leaves it out. Then there is an encounter between a Chandala and a rishi. So here the Chandala is approaching Ranthideva, this is in Srimad Bhagavatam, and he asks for food. The last bit of food that he is going to have, the king Ranthideva gives to the Chandala, and then he is going to drink water. The Chandala asks for the water also, and the king gives the water, and that is the final test. And then the Chandala says, see, I am an untouchable, if you are giving me water you will get polluted. And then the king says, I don't worry about getting polluted, Vishnu is in all the creatures, so there is no problem in me offering you the food and or offering you the water. And in case I will go to hell because I am touching you or I am sharing my food with you, then I am ready to go to hell. My dharma is only alleviating the pain of people. Now, so now what the social value that this particular story tells is very clear, and this is from the canonical Srimad Bhagavatam. So all this, they show a particular value system that there may be social exclusions and there may be reasons for it, or there may be these reasons may not be right or wrong. That is not the point. The point is, even with the socially excluded people, you should always demonstrate your humanity, and that is the real spirituality. So in a way, it is the spiritual values of Hinduism pitted against social exclusion. We are not saying that there was no caste discrimination. There was caste discrimination. Untouchability was there. And these are crimes against humanity. This is a sin against humanity. There is no doubt about it. But to pin the entire responsibility for untouchability on Hinduism, Hinduism alone, and using that to negatively stereotype Hinduism is not a proper solution. It is historically inaccurate, and it is not going to serve any proper social cause. If you really want to remove untouchability, go and find out the real cause. Do not use untouchability to negatively stereotype Hinduism. So if you approach the problem through this angle in a holistic manner, then you will be able to remove untouchability based on the very values that are enshrined in Hinduism. And Hinduism through centuries has demonstrated it, through Ramanuja, through Mahatma Gandhi, through Ambedkar. It has again and again, the Hindu culture has demonstrated that it has the spiritual strength to combat untouchability and create social justice and harmony. We'll be right back.